Working alone is a common occurrence in many workplaces. From real estate agents to oil and gas workers, working alone can present specific risks for employees.
It could be a technical risk. It could be a violence risk. It could be just simply a risk of a health issue that somebody may end up having. But the idea is that somebody, if they were to be alone, should they run into problems, how do we know they're okay? And sometimes we make some really bad assumptions, like I don't hear from them, therefore they must be okay.
The biggest issue while working alone is often the inability to reach out for help.
We all have these wonderful technologies, cell phones, etc. And we all assume that if there's a problem, people will call us. Unfortunately, what they don't realize is that cell phones require two things. They require ability and they require consciousness. So use the technology, but use it in a reversal way in that they have to call you when there's a problem. Don't wait for that to happen. Have a check-in system where they call you to tell you they are there. Now we have a check-in system to check up with them on a regular basis to make sure they're okay.
Unfortunately, to add to the problem, there is very little legislation to combat the dangers of working alone across Canada.
There's very little legislation. There are some provinces that do have legislation. Manitoba's got legislation, BC has got legislation, Alberta's got legislation. Federally, it's not direct legislation on working alone. However, what it does require in the federal regs is that an employer must conduct a risk assessment and then implement a control program to make sure that worker's safe. So indirectly, it covers all kinds of risks. In Ontario, we don't have any specific legislation. What we have in Ontario is to prove we took every precaution reasonable in the circumstances for the protection of a worker. In some scenarios, the regulations may dictate that simply by the work being done, that someone is never going to be alone. So for example, working on voltages of over a certain number of volts, you have to have somebody in the immediate vicinity who is trained in artificial respiration, which means you're never going to be alone. You're going to have that person there. Confined space would be another example. You wouldn't enter a confined space because you've got a process that people are in, you've got people standing by. They're now going to be there to help you out.
Strict legislation may not always be necessary. Common sense is often enough.
We've got enabling legislation, which doesn't cover every situation, but says, take a look at your scenario, what are the risks, and what do you have to do that's reasonable in the circumstances? So every situation is going to be different. What is that person doing? What are they expected to do? What kind of risks are involved in them doing that? Are there individual health risks just for that individual? That may be a special circumstance you need to consider as well.
A variety of tools are available to prevent dangerous situations when working alone, such as simple check-in systems.
There's all kinds of technology out there now, from man-down alarms to apps that people can download. And it basically says, where are you now? Where are you going? What time are you expected to be there? And now there's that notification process. You now notify them that you've arrived at your end. And when that person doesn't get there, it now sets off a system of checks and balances. So it will send you a second message to say you haven't replied in yet. And then when that one fails to get a communique back again from that worker, then it now sets in a system whereby it now calls the people that have been assigned as first notifiers. So it could be the person's supervisor or the person's manager to say, this person was supposed to arrive at this and this time. They have not arrived. They have not checked in. So the system can actually now do the supervising instead of a live person.